Yeah, so I was going through the brochure of this short-term course, and I'm privileged to be a part of this this illustrious list of speakers who are there. And as I can see that the aspect that I would be discussing today with you on fuel cell, it has a lot to do with electric vehicles. Okay. So I assume that at this point of time, with I was attending the morning lecture by Dr. Bohore, and there actually you got some idea regarding what is the future of electric vehicles, and that what are the challenges, and what are the as an electrical engineer, how you can contribute towards the popularity of electric vehicles. Okay, so though we are talking of electric vehicles, but always there will be some mechanical component that will be always associated with electric vehicles. As an electrical engineer, how you can contribute towards the greater acceptance, towards the increased efficiency, towards the more acceptability of vehicles, electric vehicles. So you might be knowing that this what you call the government of Delhi, they have come up with a very massive plan of electric vehicles, and it is believed by 2030 about 10% of the vehicles in the city of electric vehicles. And so I will be discussing more and to some extent themselves, and in what way we can that how power electronics and control engineering are related to this fuel cells, related to electric vehicles, and how they are related to how fuel cells contribute towards the popularity of electric vehicles. I cannot see that file sharing of
sir,
So by the way, I'd like to make this presentation as basic as possible, okay, and I would not be going into something which is too much of technical or too much of research oriented. I understand that all of you may be coming from different backgrounds, so the research component I would be not discussing to a greater extent, but if you are from a control engineering background or from power electronics background, in what angle you would be looking at electric vehicles, to that is the main aspect I will be looking into. And I would want that you contribute equally in this lecture from your end also, so you can interrupt me as many number of times as you want. And since this topic is quite new to most of you, you can ask the most basic of questions, okay, and don't bother about it that whether it is a somewhat related to fuel cell or electric vehicles or not. Okay, so now I go to my presentation. I think my screen is not shared.
So your screen is shared and your presentation is visible.
Okay, so since you have gone through this how do you call some basic thing about electric vehicles, right? And I suppose there was a lecture on photovoltaic also. I would start with a very basic thing, right? Now most of the distributed energy resources, whether you talk of fuel cell, whether you talk of photovoltaics, or whether you talk of wind energy, what is the basic difference in between those renewable sources? Suppose let us start with a very basic thing.
just a minute. Yeah. When you solve an electrical circuit, you might be solving that electrical circuit in say a basic electrical engineering class or a circuit theory class. Now I tell you that when you solve a circuit like this, okay, this is one circuit that all of you might have solved, right? Now most of the times we are considering it as a battery. Most of the times we are considering it as a battery and it has a fixed source. Okay. Now when I replace this source by either a fuel cell, let us not talk about fuel cell for the time being. If I replace it by a photovoltaic panel, okay, right. The network theorems that you have studied, will it be applicable here? Yes or no? I suppose the question is clear to all of you. You have solved all these circuits by Ankita. Yes, Ankita, can you hear me?
Yes, sir,
Ankita, even that whenever there is a loss of connectivity, na, immediately you call me or drop a message in WhatsApp. Okay.
Yes, right. Sir. Yes,
okay.
Sir.
So I start with a very basic thing, right? When you solve an electrical circuit, it may be a purely resistive circuit, a RL circuit, RC circuit, or a RLC circuit, right? We consider as a DC source. Let us right now consider only DC circuits only. Now, when I replace this DC circuit by any renewable energy source, whether it is a photovoltaic panel or whether it is a wind energy source or whether it is a fuel cell, whether it is a ultracapacitor or anything like that. So the network theorems that you have studied in your first year or second year of your BTech, are those theorems applicable here? Those theorems are not directly applicable because the main problem comes, we are not considering a fixed DC source, but we are considering whenever we are dealing with any renewable energy source, we are dealing with a varying voltage source. Okay, and even with a varying voltage source, suppose you have a varying voltage source and you have a varying resistance also here. Okay, right. Now the problem is that when the resistance changes, right, the voltage that is fed by the DC source here, that also changes. Are you able to get it? So previously, when you are solving those circuits, you are talking of dependent sources, right? You have a DC source which is dependent. But here the peculiar scenario with most of the renewable sources is that here you are having a DC source which is dependent on the value of the load, which is somewhat way different from what we have been told in our basic electrical engineering class and what we have been told in our circuit theory class. Right. So circuit theory class, what it tells us, circuit theory class tells us is that if you have a dependent source, that source will depend on the current and voltage in some other part of the circuit. But here we are talking of a scenario where the voltage output of this source, first of all, it is not a fixed source. It is a variable source and it is also dependent. And it is dependent on what? It is dependent on how much load that you have connected. Okay. So that is actually one of the main difference in between solving circuits by conventional circuits which are of fixed value and by solving circuits which are renewable in nature or which are dependent on not only on the load but they are dependent on a large number of environmental factors and weather condition. Okay, so one of these renewable sources is something which you call it as a fuel cell. Okay, right. Now let us take a very simple example. So suppose you have a vehicle. Okay, right now I am not saying that whether it is an electric vehicle or whether it is the vehicle that you are having, whether it is a bike or a car. So you have a vehicle, right? So now this vehicle, it has to cover this path. Okay, maybe from here to here it is a 10 kilometer distance that this vehicle has to cover. Okay, right. So when this vehicle goes, initially what it is doing is that it is moving on a uniform path, and after that there is some slope. Okay, maybe a sort of a hilly area or something like that, and then after that it again comes down to the normal course. Okay, right. So when you talk of a VKL, now let us think of this VKL as a load. Okay, let us think of this VKL as a load. This VKL has to be fed by some electrical energy. Right. Okay. Now, what are the options available to you? Like most of the times, whenever you talk of electric vehicles, you talk of battery. Okay, you talk of battery. Okay, so let us say that you have charged the battery to a great extent and from here to here it is moving. Okay, right. After this, when this position comes that it has to move up, do you think that the battery, whatever the energy or whatever the power that the battery has, that will be sufficient to meet the load requirement? Yes or no? No. Okay, so there is, so don't, most of the times whenever we think of electric vehicles we talk of battery, but isn't, from this example, don't you get an idea that with this battery, if you have some other source, at some other energy source, maybe photovoltaic or which may be fuel cell, somehow the overall productivity or overall efficiency or overall acceptance of the electric vehicle will be higher. As you all know that presently, whatever the electric vehicles that we have, mainly if you have seen those e-bikes, you have seen that charging those, electric vehicles is a big problem because one of the major hindrance towards the popularity of electric vehicles in India is that we don't know that whether we would be able to have as many number of electric charging stations, which actually is required, okay? But if, even to this day, there are in a city like Raipur, there are very few electrical charging stations, right? So charging is a very big issue. And how you can avoid your dependence on charging? You can avoid your dependence on charging when, along with battery, if you have some other source. Okay, so other source may be say PV or it may be a fuel cell. Now let us talk of PV. Now the thing is that you know that this PV power is not constant, it is intermittent in nature, it is dependent on the weather condition. Okay, so what you can do is that when the PV power, suppose I am having two sources, okay, I am having two sources, right? So what are the two sources? You have a battery, you have a PV. So PV is my primary source. So PV is my primary source in the sense what? That whenever I have sufficient PV power, PV output, what I will do is that this entire load will be met by the PV output. Okay, so let us say that the load requirement is P, the output of PV is PPV, and the output of the battery is PB. Okay, and this is what P, P is the load requirement of the vehicle. So initially it is somewhat low, okay. In it, it is not only low, but it is constant. And after that, when it rises, this power suddenly increases. Okay. So there is a possibility that PPV may be greater than P. Or in other words, what I mean to say is that the power output of the photovoltaic panel is greater than the power that is required by the load. So what does it mean? It is a very good scenario in the sense that you have some excess power, which is PPV minus P. Yes or no? See, you please answer something, huh? That will motivate me. Wait, is wrong or wrong? Huh? Okay. So you have this much amount of excess power. Okay. Because maybe it is 1 o'clock in the noon or 2 o'clock in the noon. I have very good irradiance and the power output of the PV panel is very high. And with this extra power, I am not only able to meet the load requirement, but even after meeting the load requirement, I have this much amount of power. So any idea, shall I waste this power or shall I use this power for some good work? Use the power. And what is the best way of using the power is to charge the battery. Okay, right. So whatever this excess power that you will be having with that, what you would be doing is that you would be charging the battery. You would be charging the battery, and maybe when this scenario comes, when P has suddenly increased, in that case, there may be possibility that PPV may be less than P. It means what? the PV power is not sufficient enough to meet. From where this power will come, the deficiency in power, from where it will come? Any idea?
From the batteries.
From the battery. From the battery it will come. Why? Because for some scenario before this has happened, you have done a very good thing of charging the battery. Okay. So this particular deficiency of power that you presently are having, that will be made by the battery. Okay. So that at all instant of time, PPV plus PB will be equal to P. Okay. Sometimes it may be zero. Sometimes this may be zero. Okay. So when this is zero, you need to charge this. Okay. So this is something called a very widely used term that is being, a lot of research is going on in it, and we call it energy management. Okay. Energy management basically means that you have a load and the load requirement is continuously changing. Okay. And when the load requirement is changing, you don't have, you are not having a single source, you are having multiple sources. And when you are having multiple sources, now what is the best way of using those multiple sources? What you would be doing is that you have to divide this power judiciously in between this and this. Okay. So that is actually now there is fuel cell coming in the picture. Now fuel cell is coming in the picture in the sense that there is something called power density, and there is something called energy density. Anybody has any idea on it? Okay, let me tell you. Okay. Now, I again come back to this, this example. Now, suppose a vehicle has to cover 5 kilometers with a constant speed, okay, for 2 hours. A vehicle has to cover 5 kilometers at a constant speed for 2 hours. You can determine the velocity from it, okay, speed versus distance. Distance versus time. Okay. Right. Now, another requirement is that, so from here to here, it is 5 kilometers. Now, another requirement is that the vehicle has to move from here to here. It has to climb a hill within 10 minutes. Okay. Now, in which of the two cases more power is required? In which of the two cases more energy is required? Think about a bit. Very good. Very good. Second case, it will be power, because power is what? It is the rate of doing energy, rate of energy consumption. Okay. So when you have to do something within a very short interval of time. Okay. So when you have to do something within a very short interval of time, in that case, what does it mean? It means that the power requirement, because the time here to here is very less, whatever the energy that you have, that you have to dissipate within that very small interval of time. So from here, when the requirement of the vehicle is to cover a say hill within a very short distance, it means what? A sudden burst of energy or a sudden consumption of energy is required. Okay, but here, when the vehicle is moving at a constant speed, it means what? The energy source has to deliver that energy at a fixed value over a long interval of time. So when it has to cover, it has to dissipate energy over a long interval of time, a constant value of energy over a long interval of time, in that case, the source, it may be battery, it may be photovoltaic, it may be ultra capacitor, it may be fuel cell. In that case, it should have good energy density. But when the vehicle has to cover consume huge amount of energy within a very short interval of time, in that case, the requirement of the source should be power density. Okay, that source should have high power density, right? But there is no source which is available to us, okay, which has got both good power density as well as good energy density. Are you able to get it? Right. Each source has it, what you call limitation. A source which has got good energy density may have low power density, okay, and a source which has got high power density may have low energy density. Now let me draw you a figure here, okay. So if I'm talking of here energy density, I call it ED, and here I'm calling it as a power density. Okay, right. Now, can you tell me these capacitors that you have in your lab? Okay, right. They have good power density or they have good energy density? A normal capacitor. Power density. Okay, suppose I'm having a capacitor, I connect a load across it. Okay, at time t is equal to zero, I close this switch. Okay, then what will happen? Say this is of one, I had initially charged this capacitor. Okay, this capacitor is having any charge, and then I connect a load across it, a small resistance across it. So tau is equal to RC. Okay, so this time constant is what? The time constant actually is related to, is directly proportional to how fast this capacitor will be able to discharge its energy across the resistors. And what is the value of capacitance here? The value of capacitance, it is in microfarad. So even if I connect a 1 kilo ohm resistance across it, the time constant will be in milliseconds. Okay, so it is able to deliver whatever the energy that the capacitor has within a very short interval of time. So it means what? The capacitor is having a very, say I call it capacitor. I mean to say that why I have written capacitor here, because it is having very high power density, but it is having low energy density. Okay, right. Now, battery will become battery will higher energy density as compared to capacitor. Okay, right. Okay, high. So battery will come somewhere here. Okay. When I draw here, it means that it is a point. It has this much amount of power density and it has this much amount of energy density. There is a point here also. Okay. Now, fuel cell is something which comes here, which has a very, very high energy density, but very low power density. Okay. So call it FC. FC is coming somewhere here. Okay. How many of you have heard of this term, a special type of capacitor which we call it as ultra capacitor? Anybody hear of it? Sometimes they are called it as super capacitor. So I can tell you that this has a huge future. Yes, go ahead. Where it will come, can you tell me? High power density, higher than capacitors? No, not. See, you are right to a certain extent. Achha, can you tell me that during your 10 plus 2 or during the first year of your engineering, whenever you had studied about storage of energy, okay, you had studied about both battery as well as capacitors? Yes or no? These are the two things we understand, that there is a battery in which there is a chemical reaction takes place by which we are able to store energy. Now, capacitors also can store energy, E is equal to half CV square. Okay, right. Now, why is that? We have two fundamental elements in electrical engineering, battery and capacitor, which both can store energy. But whenever we are actually talking of energy storage in real life, we are only talking of battery. We as such are not using capacitor for energy storage. Whether you talk of the UPS that you use in your home or in your office, or you talk of energy storage in vehicles, or whether you talk of energy storage in power plants, everywhere we are using huge number of battery. We have a battery room. Even in if you have gone to a PV power plant, you will find that a substantial portion of that PV power plant is occupied by battery. Okay. So my question is that even though both battery as well as a capacitor can store energy, but why is that we are only using battery and we are not using capacitor to a great extent? Anybody has an answer to it? The basic reason is that Capacitor has a very good thing. Capacitor has a very good thing, like for scenarios like this, where you have to dissipate enough amount of energy within a very short interval of time that the capacitors can do. Okay, because tau is equal to RC. Now the problem with capacitors is E is equal to half CV square. What is the maximum value of capacitance that you have seen in your life? What is the maximum value of capacitance that you have seen either in lab or somewhere else? Yes, anybody? Most of the times it is in microfarad, sometimes I have come across in millifarad also. Okay, right. So the problem is that the problem with capacitors is that even though they are having a high power density, the problem with capacitors is that when you are talking of half CV square, and if this value C is in 10 to the power of minus 3 or 10 to the power of minus 6, ultimately what happens is that the amount of energy that you can store in electrolytic capacitors that you have in your lab, it is very less. Okay, irrespective of how much, whatever may be the value of voltage or other, because if you have to make it high, since the value is, this value is in 10 to the power of minus 3 or 10 to the power of minus 6, you have to charge it to a very high value of voltage source. Okay, right. So ultimately, though the power density of capacitor is high, but the energy storage capacity of electrolytic capacitors is very low. Okay, right. I think all of you can appreciate it. Now, somehow, if you are able to increase the value of this to farads or kilofarads, somehow, if you are able to increase the value of capacitors from farads to kilofarads, okay. So if you have to increase it to kilofarad, C is equal to epsilon A by D. What you have to do? This you cannot change to a great extent. Either you have to go for very high cross section, or you have to reduce the distance in between the two plates of the capacitor. But that is not feasible, because then the permittivity, because ultimately whatever the dielectric medium that you have in between the two plates, they will not be able to play the role properly. Okay, right. So that's why if we are somehow able to increase the value of capacitance to say farad or kilofarad, we cannot have this formula for that, or you cannot have the construction of an electrolytic capacitors. Now they are actually where these super capacitors or ultra capacitors are coming into picture. Ultra capacitors or super capacitors, they are capacitors which are having a very high value of capacitance with the same physical size as that of an electrolytic capacitor. Okay, so I can say that in my lab I have a 10 farad ultra capacitor which I can hold in my palm. Okay, 10 farad ultra capacitor which I can hold in my palm, and if the value of this capacitance is 10 farad, you can see that the problem that we initially associated with the energy storage capability of capacitor, that this is low, we are able to get rid of it. So there actually the importance of ultra capacitors are coming into the picture. But naturally, when the value of capacitance we are increasing, the time constant will increase, tau equal to RC will increase. And once this time constant increases, the power density will reduce, but the energy density will rise. So ultra capacitors are capacitors which have a high energy density as compared to normal electrolytic capacitors, but which have a power density somewhat lesser than the normal electrolytic capacitor. So they lie somewhere here. I call it ultra capacitor. Okay. Are you able to get it? Yes,
yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
Right. Okay, so now here I want, before I wish to go for fuel cell, I would like to, this is what I wanted to discuss. The thing is that you should appreciate why whenever we talk of electric vehicle or we talk of any other application where renewable sources are involved, one fundamental thing that you have to appreciate is that no single source is able to meet the requirement of the load always. Okay, no single source would be able to meet the requirement of the load always, because the load requirement is continuously changing. Okay, so what you have to do, because all, why no single source will be able to meet the requirement? Of course, the one thing is that the capacity of a single source is less, right? And so you need more sources to meet the energy or the power requirement. But more than the level or the magnitude of energy or the magnitude of power, the why do we need multiple sources is that every renewable source, every distributed energy source, they have their own advantage, they have their own disadvantage. Okay, so depending on the load scenario, certain sources may be good under a certain scenario, certain sources may not be good at a certain scenario. Okay, so what is the solution for it? The solution for is that you won't be having a single source, but you would be having a multiple sources. And what are those multiple sources? Capacitors are not used because it is so less, the energy density the energy storage capacity. Most of the times you will find that electric vehicles are composed of these three sources. They have a fuel cell, they have a battery, and they have an ultra capacitor, so that whether it is moving at a constant speed or whether it has to climb up a hill at a certain velocity, okay, all these requirements will be met by a hybridization of these sources. Okay, right. So that is what I meant by energy management. So before, always keep in mind is that fuel cell is never used alone. Ultra capacitor is never used alone. Battery can be used alone to a certain extent, but those vehicles have a very lesser efficiency or a very lesser productivity. So the best option is that you have to have multiple sources. Okay, right. So actually, I should before going into fuel cell, I thought I should discuss about energy management. Why this energy management is required? Okay, then I would be going into fuel cells. So this is how I would be proceeding during the course of my presentation. I had discussed this. I had discussed first. Then I'd be going towards what actually is fuel cell, and then this part has been covered in this FDP. Yes, anybody, any faculty or any expert has covered this part before? Not in fuel cell, or maybe in photovoltaic or in wind. Yes, has it been covered in the previous lectures?
No sir.
Okay. So this I will discuss a bit. Okay, because this is I can say that most of the research in PV or in, for that matter, any other renewable sources is being carried out on this, and it is a very big problem. Okay, I'll be discussing about it, and then I will be discussing about a bit about this controller design for fuel cell. Why actually do we need a controller? Okay. The normal battery that we use in our laptops, or whether they are having a controller or not, or in hot way, this controller is designed and things like that, that I will discuss a bit. Then I will again come back to electric vehicles, and finally some conclusions about the present status of electric vehicles and fuel cells, and what we can anticipate in future. Okay. Okay. So there are two words. One is fuel, the other is cell. Okay, I think all of you know what is a cell. You can say that it is a fuel cell. Generally, a battery, we call it a cell, right? So the basically it is a energy source which provides you an output, and it is powered by a fuel. You can say that like every source has certain energy conversion. We have the solar energy to electrical energy conversion in photovoltaics. You have this wind energy to electrical energy conversion in windmills. Okay, and in fuel cells, what generally happens is that we have a chemical energy to electrical energy conversion. The similar thing that happens in the battery. Okay, so you have a chemical reaction taking place, and because of the chemical reaction taking place, there are electrons that are emitted. And when the electrons are emitted, okay, and when you connect something across that source, what will happen? There will be flow of electrons, and the flow of electrons actually constitute what? The flow of electrons actually constitute energy. Okay, so that is how the name fuel cell comes. Okay, and then it has, why fuel cell is so much into the picture in electric vehicles? It has 3-fold increase in efficiency as compared to combustion engine. Okay, so the normal these mechanical vehicles or these combustion IC engine based vehicles that we have, this fuel cell has a almost 3 times increase in the efficiency. Now the whenever we talk of electric vehicles, again and again I am saying we are talking of battery, and the charging issues in the battery are avoided. Okay, because as I named, as I have told you that the growth of electric vehicles in India has been hindered in the last few years mainly because of the lack of charging stations. Okay, because we don't have entrepreneurs who are coming to that extent, because so much of investment is required to, I think in the last lecture Professor Bohra might have discussed about it, that why coming up with a charging station and providing a proper tariff is such an issue for battery powered vehicles, right? And the emission is zero. Okay, right, the almost zero emission, and it is having a noise free operation, no noise as such. Okay, so if anybody of you it is have visited Delhi, you see that the LPG what you call these buses that you have, you don't know when the buses start. Okay, so fuel cell vehicles are also similar to it, and these are the two actually challenges or two disadvantages. There are safety issues. Okay, there are safety issues because hydrogen production is involved here. Okay, since hydrogen is involved, and hydrogen is a gas which is you cannot smell. Okay, so if there is a leakage of hydrogen and all that, that will create an havoc, and so that is an one issue. And presently the cost of fuel cell is very high. We have a 1.2 kilowatt fuel cell in our lab and it costs somewhere around 12 lakhs. Okay, so these are the advantages and disadvantages. And fortunately in India a very what you call good progress has been made with regard to this fuel cell vehicles, and this the Tata Motors have manufactured this this bus. Okay, it is a complete made in India product, and Tata Motors has developed it with partnership from ISRO. So yeah, so basically we are calling it in electrochemical devices. It is not proper to say device, okay, because the source is generally not referred to as a device. It converts chemical energy into electrical energy. Okay, and it has a unique combination of high energy density, high efficiency, modularity. Modularity in the sense is that just as you have a stack of PV panels which cover a large amount of area, you also have a stack of PV cells, and they are very small in size, and that actually leads to their modular operation, right? It is more renewable than another resources like PV and wind based system. The reason of this high reliability is that unlike these two sources which are highly dependent on weather, okay, which are highly dependent on weather, fuel cells are not dependent on weather, not at all dependent on weather, because their operation, the what you call the raw material that is used for this fuel cells is hydrogen gas. So you can have a hydrogen chamber, hydrogen production module that will produce, as long as the hydrogen is being produced there, you don't have to depend on either the solar irradiance and you don't have to depend on wind velocity. Okay, for the fuel cell systems that consume hydrogen directly, the only byproduct, okay, is electricity, water and heat. Okay, and the water, so this is the what you call, you can say that this is the input, okay, and these are the outputs. Okay, these are the outputs. Okay, so these are the outputs. So electricity or the flow of electrons is something that you want. Water, the good thing about the water is that it is, the water gets evaporated, so you don't get droplets as such. And heat, and heat is also not to that extent that it gets what you call that it creates a lot of problem. A small sink will be able to do it. Now this diagram actually tells you about the operation of the fuel cell. So what happens, you have some hydrogen gas which is coming here, and just like a battery, it has got two panels, one is the cathode and the other is the anode. Okay, and you have a load, so these are the two ends of the battery, and sorry, of the fuel cell, and then you have an electrical load which is connected across it. So at the anode, here we have the anode. Okay, so at the anode what comes, hydrogen comes, it is broken to electrons and H plus ions. Okay, so here, then what is happens is that this H plus ions, it moves through this membrane. Okay, so there is a proton exchange membrane in between the anode and the cathode. Okay, so the electrons, So at this point, you have both electrons as well as hydrogen ions. Electron ions go through this electrical path, and the hydrogen ions, they go through the membrane and they reach the cathode. Okay, so these two ions, they are reaching the here. They are these hydrogen ions, they are reaching the cathode. Okay, here, and at the cathode we have oxygen supply. So oxygen comes here, and these electrons that moves through this path, they again come back here. Okay, so finally at the cathode, what happens? We get water, and that is evaporated through this. Okay, so finally, what we are interested in? Finally, we are interested in this flow of electrons, which is happening across the load that you have connected it. So that constitute the flow, the conversion of electric, this chemical energy derived from the ionization of hydrogen to conversion to electrical energy. So I'm not going too much into this. The what are the challenges with actually this is a type of fuel cell. Okay, it is called proton exchange membrane fuel cell. There are various types of fuel cells, and fuel cells are basically, they are classified based on the type of membrane that is being used. Okay, so this type of fuel cell, it is a proton exchange membrane. Okay, so it you don't go too much into this. You, whenever I am talking of PEMFC, you think that it is a fuel cell only. Okay, so what are the challenges? For every fuel cell, the voltage availability is quite less. Okay, so you can see that you have a output which is quite less. So this we can, what you call, how we can overcome this problem? Then we can connect a large number of such cells in series. We can overcome this problem, or the best way of doing it is that we can have a DC-DC converter. Okay, we can have a DC-DC converter. DC-DC boost converter. Okay, so generally fuel cell is never used as a single cell, and it is used as a multiple cells because the voltage availability is very less. And even with multiple cells, we need a boost converter, because even with multiple cells, the output is very less. Suppose if I connect 10, then also on the, I get a output in between 6 volt to 1.2 volt. Okay, right. The meeting the load voltage requires a high number of cells, resulting in significant increase in the production cost and complexity. This, and it is difficult to maintain uniform temperature, pressure and humidity throughout this tank. So the last diagram that you have seen, the entire operation has to be carried out at a uniform temperature. So sometimes maintaining a uniform temperature, because your vehicle, you have that whole setup in your vehicle, and your vehicle is moving in a say mountainous range where, or in a region where the temperature is very less. So the ambient temperature is very less. Even then you have to maintain the uniform temperature. So that is sometimes a challenge. And this is the non-linear relationship in between the stack voltage. Stack voltage is the final voltage that you connect, and stack is what? Stack is a combination of cells connected in series parallel way. Okay, so non-relationship in between the stack voltage and power. Okay, so this is what I had talked to you previously. So if I connect a load, okay, the problem is that when I connect a load, the output of the fuel cell is dependent on how much load that I have connected. Okay, so that's why you need a regulated output. Regulated output in the sense is that irrespective of how, whether I change the value of load, I should always get a constant output across it. And that is only possible when you have a controller with this DC-DC converter. I am coming to it. And this fuel hydrogen available in compound state requires an additional electrolyzer system. So production of hydrogen is a problem, and that actually is hindering the popularity of fuel cell. It is a very complex task to produce hydrogen, and for that we need a completely different module of an electrolyzer. Okay. See, again and again I'm telling, if you have any doubt, you please ask any question. That will also, I will also feel that you are able to adopt something. Otherwise, I am speaking something, it is not. If anybody has any question, please, you can go ahead. And don't, don't restrict your question to only fuel cell. You can have questions related to ultra capacitors, battery, or what you call PV panels also. Okay, because if you see the overall components that are required in any distributed energy source, in any renewable source, it is more or less same. The primary requirement is that you should have a regulated output. For that, you need a controller. You should be able to extract maximum power from the renewable source. Okay, and for that, you need the maximum power tracking. These two things are common, and these two things are always there. Okay, so if you have any doubt, you can please ask me. So here I'm talking of something which is called power conditioning unit. So basically it is either it is a converter or an inverter system. Okay, I'm not going into inverter in the present lecture because we are only dealing with both DC source as well as DC load. Okay, right. Now the same thing again, you have a fuel cell. Okay. You have a load. I change the load. Okay, right. So when I change the load, the chemical reaction that is taking place in the fuel cell, that also gets changed. And once that gets changed, the output of the fuel cell gets changed. It happens with almost all the renewable sources. But what I want is that I need a constant output here. Okay. Constant output, even if I call this IL. Okay, I want this output to be constant, irrespective of whatever the changes that I make in the load. So even if IL changes, IL may increase or decrease, but this V naught should remain constant. How can we do it? Any idea? Yes, please go ahead. You can use a DC to DC converter. Okay. Yeah, very good. Now, so what I will do, I have a fuel cell. And then I add a Now, if you look at the circuit from here, can't we say that now my load is not only this load, but it is actually this load? This is my load? Yes or no? When I insert a DC-DC converter here, right? When I insert a DC-DC converter here, when I look at the circuit from this end, when I look at this circuit, now, what is the load that is being fed by the fuel cell? It is this DC-DC converter plus the load. Yes or no?
Yes.
So if I have to make this constant, okay, right, irrespective of change in IL, what I can do? I have to change this impedance. Impedance between this and this, if you apply Thevenin equivalent from here to here, if I have to make this constant, even if this changes, this output changes, so I can do something in this, yes or no? Something in this part. When I say something in this part, what I mean to say is that I can change the impedance of this component so that even if IL changes, I am able to make this V naught constant. Yes or no? Okay, right. So it is something like this. I have a source. I have drawn it in series. Okay, this is variable. Okay, so I have to maintain this constant. Okay, and this is, I suppose, VI. Right, so whether if this changes, I want V naught not to change. So V naught not to change, VI is constant. So to make V naught constant, what I have to do, the voltage drop that is taking place here, let us say called it VC, I can modify it. I can VC, if I can modify, I can always make V naught constant. And how I can modify VC? By changing the impedance here. Now you think of DC-DC converter, it will not be in series, of course. When I talk of this DC-DC converter, you think of this DC-DC converter as this impedance. Okay, so if I am able to change the impedance of this DC-DC converter, I would be able to maintain a constant voltage output here, irrespective of whatever the changes that is either taking place here or irrespective of either the changes that is taking place here. Okay, so for that, what I have to do, I have to continuously monitor this current, this voltage, and this voltage, right? So this is what you call it as. So for that, what I need, when I say that, I have to change this impedance, how much amount of change has to be made in this impedance, that will depend on what is the, how much the voltage has deviated from V0, how much current is now flowing here, and what is the output here. Okay, then only I would be able to, based on that information, I would be able to change this impedance. Okay, so that how much of change is required in the value of impedance. And now when I talk of a DC-DC converter, you know what is there in a DC-DC converter. You have passive elements, you have inductor, you have capacitor, you have resistance. Okay, so you cannot change the value of those inductor and capacitor. Then what you can change in the DC-DC converter so that the effective impedance changes of the DC-DC converter. You know, na, a DC-DC converter is made up of passive elements. Okay, so you cannot change the value of online, you cannot change the value of the inductor or the capacitor. Then what is left there within in you to change in the DC-DC converter so that you are able to achieve a constant output here? Yes, anybody? Exactly. You have got a switch, and how you are switching, when you are turning on, when you are turning off, I think all of you are familiar with the term duty cycle. Okay, so what is the duty ratio and all that? So that impedance is a highly nonlinear system. Okay, so what we can do is that we can play with the duty ratio, we can play with the switching of the DC-DC converter so that this output is maintained constant. And for that, what we need a controller, and this controller will decide. And what the controller does, the controller takes information about the load, that is the load current, load voltage. It also takes information regarding the source, how much is the source output. These two information goes here. Okay, these two information goes here, and then the controller decide how much should I change the duty ratio of the power electronic converter so that this V output is maintained. Okay, and this is one aspect that happens in almost all the, what you call, renewable energy resources, right? This I think might be known to most of you, but still I thought that it is better to describe it. Okay, so there is nothing big thing here, but so that's why there is a lot of control system that is coming into the picture. Okay, so you see that most of the guys who are doing research on power, either converter design, inverter design, they need to have some knowledge regarding what you call the controllers, right? And basically we start with a PID controller, and then we go for some advanced control. Yes, please. Yeah, you have. Please. Okay, so this is what the variation in load and the variation in source. So this is very difficult, okay, because it is not only your load which is changing, it is your source is also continuously changing. And okay, right, it is not only the, and you don't have any control over this. 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 Why? Because your application is such that it requires a continuous varying load, a dynamic load, right? So there are two things required. One is the load voltage regulation that I have told you. Okay. And this thing, I don't think I need to discuss here. I'll be coming down to later. And there is some work that we have done. I don't know whether I would be able to discuss with it. we have gone for a fractional order controller, how we have designed a fractional order controller for maintaining the output voltage to be constant, that I will discuss a bit. Right. This is what I was talking of. Yeah. So now you see, you have an ultra capacitor, you have a fuel cell, you have a battery. Okay. And you have your vehicle. This is your vehicle. And you have to optimally use these three sources. Okay. You have to optimally use these three sources so that this power requirement of the load is being met. So what you have? You have individual DC-DC converters for all the three sources. Like in this topology, it is shown to have, they have used three independent, dedicated DC-DC converters for each of the sources, right? But they, it is a possible that a single, there are some, Lalit Kumar in our department is working. What they do is that they have a single DC-DC converter. It may not be possible for this case, but there are cases where it is possible. Now, one thing I ask you, the flow of the current will be from the source to the load. Okay, the flow of the power will be from the source to the load. It always happens, na? Right? Until and unless you are having a microgrid or a smart grid, it is the power that comes from the generating station to your home. You do not produce any power that goes back. Okay, so this is what we have been studying till now. Okay, or at least we have studied in our BTEC. Now, can you tell me the converter for the fuel cell will be similar to the converter for the supercapacitor? Supercapacitor is nothing but the ultracapacitor and the battery. Or will there be any difference in between the converter for the fuel cell and the converter for the battery? Yes, make a guess. Or they will be similar. When I say that similar, of course, there will be change in the rating of the value of the inductor capacitor will be different for both the two. That's a different aspect. But overall structure in terms of talking in terms of the overall structure or talking in terms of the overall mechanism, will there be any difference in between this DC-DC converter, which is for the fuel cell, and this DC-DC converter, which is for the battery? Yeah. There should not be any difference. Okay. Now, the flow of the current will be in this direction, of course, because the fuel cell is a source, it has to provide the power. So the flow of the current will be like this. Now, what about the battery? The flow of the current will always be like this, or there is a possibility that the flow of the current may be like this also? Yes, please. Maybe, because when you are charging the battery, you need your the flow of the current to be like this. And when you are discharging the battery, then the flow like this. Is it clear to all of you? Okay.
Yes, sir.
So that's why I am talking of, there is something called bidirectional converter. Okay. There is something called bidirectional converter. So for the battery, since charging is involved, and for the supercapacitor, there also charging is involved, you need to have a bi-directional converter, whereas for this fuel cell you need to have a unidirectional converter. Okay, right. Now another example I would like to tell you. I think all of you have some basic idea regarding power system. Now what happens, suppose let us take a very simple power system. Okay, right. You have two sources, and this is the transmission line, and there are certain loads which are connected here and connected here. Right. Okay. Now, let us say that. Just a minute. She is looking for how to use the eraser here. Anyway, let me draw. I don't know how it is. Anybody can help me? Okay. No issue. ठीक है, लीव इट, लीव इट. ओके, नो इश्यू. हाँ हाँ, जस्ट एक मिनट.
इधर हम तो कर देता है यार, रिवर्स.
ठीक है, रहने दो, रहने दो, रहने दो. ओके, अच्छा, जस्ट एक मिनट. ओके, व्हाट आई मीन टू से इज दैट दिस आर नॉट एसी सोर्सेस, दिस आर से पीवी. जस्ट आई मीन टू से दैट दिस आर नॉट एसी सोर्सेस, दिस आर सम डीईआर से. Now what happens? So you have a actually there are a lot of things which are here. I'm not going into it because you cannot have a PV panel directly connected to the transmission line. There will be a DC-DC converter here. There will be DC-DC converter here. Okay. So discussing here only. Suppose a fault takes place here. Okay. A fault takes place in the transmission line. You know that if the line current is I1, after the fault has taken place, there may be 10 times increase in the current in the line. Yes or no? Any line to ground fault is generally what happens is that the current increases by 10 to 15 times. Yeah. Now think of, you have a microgrid. Okay, in that microgrid, a fault has taken place. What are the sources? You have PV panels and you have wind energy sources. Okay, now when I say that the current has increased by 10 times, now what is this current? This current is a sort of load to the PV panel, yes or no? Okay, so you think of a scenario when you have a source and when you have a load. Now suddenly this IL has become 10 IL. Will the source be able to provide as much amount of energy or power, whatever you say? That is it. No. Okay. Then. Okay. Okay. Yes. I agree to it. Any other option that you have? But still, 10 times, what you are saying is absolutely correct, but 10 times may not be possible to that extent. Okay, so with the reactive power control, you may be able to meet the requirement, but 10 times or 20 times, it may not be possible. Okay, right. So, how you can do it? See, generally what happens now, when you are talking of a grid, our grid is huge. Okay, this grid can provide, this grid will be able to tolerate it, this 10 times increase in the current, and by using that whatever you said about that reactive power control, for a normal grid we may be able to do it. Okay, but when you talk of this PV panels which have a very limited capacity, okay, they may not be able to do it. So here again the question of the limited power density of the source is coming into the picture. You know that a fault generally takes place in a fraction of a cycle. Fraction of a cycle means that a 5 to 6 millisecond. In DC microgrids, it happens even faster. Okay. So within that small interval of time, you have to provide that much amount of power, which may not be possible with a PV panel or with any other source having a low energy power density. So here again, also the question of supercapacitors come into picture. Okay, because they have a somewhat better power density. So what we need to do, we have to compensate for the low capacity or low power density of the PV panel by supercapacitor. I again come back to the same thing. The only thing I want to realize you people is that the energy management is very important, whether you talk of electric vehicle, whether you talk of microgrid, or you talk of energy, any renewable source application, right? So you have to have one source which is the primary source, but at the same time you need to have a secondary or a tertiary source, because the primary source may not be always able to meet the requirement. this one such scenario happens when there is a fault in the microgrid. Because of the fault in the microgrid, the current increases substantially. So the PV panel, we may not, what somebody of you have said regarding the reactive power control, you may be able to do it maybe to 4 or 5 times, but not 10 or 20 times. So in that case, what will happen? You need a super capacitor. So in that case, this 10I1, if I divide it into 5I1, and then again 5-1, maybe this 5-I-1 may be met by whatever the reactive power control by the PV panel, and this 5-I-1 will come from the other source, which, since it has to be generated in a small interval of time, we have to go for supercapacitor or ultracapacitor. Okay, so I don't think how much time I have left. Yes, Ankita, how much time I have left?
Sir, there are 15 minutes more to the session.
Okay, but in the meantime, you have to have. Okay, let me try to wind up. I need to take some questions also. Na? Yeah.
Yes.
So this is actually in our lab, we have this experimental setup. Now, can anybody say what it is? This one? Hydrogen cylinder. Okay, right. And this is our this 2 that is written here. It is our fuel cell. Okay, this is the fuel cell. So it has an anode, a cathode, and 2 chambers. And this hydrogen supply goes as an input to this fuel cell. And by the way, how many of you have heard of this term before? Huh? These 2 terms, how many of you have heard before?
Yes, sir.
I'm not talking of those who have done PhD. Okay. Okay. Anything? See, the thing is, whenever I have talking of controller, what is a controller? By the way, a controller is a hardware or a software? A very basic question. A controller is a hardware or a software, or it is both? If I have to use a controller for the DC-DC converter, it should be a hardware or a software, or both?
Both.
Okay, both in the sense, like whenever we are talking of digital controller, so what we do is that whatever the control algorithms that you have studied in your BTech, like PID controller, PI controller, and PD controller. So first of all, you have to write a code for that, and then you have to implement it digitally. Okay, so that is what we call it as a digital controller. So here, this is the block diagram. Here we have the block diagram, and here we have the experimental setup. Now, starting from the left, so what we need, first of all, we need a source. Okay, first of all, we need a source. And what is our source? Our source is this this fuel cell. Okay, 2 fuel cell, which is powered by a hydrogen cylinder. After the source, what comes? At the end, we have the load. Okay, so in between the source, we have seen that we cannot connect the source directly to the load, because both our source is variable as well as our load is variable. So what will come here in between the source and the load? We will come as a power conditioning unit or a DC-DC converter. Okay, right. So if you see here that, and to after this DC-DC converter, so here you have the DC-DC converter. Okay. And here this DC-DC converter has been implemented here in this. Sorry, this is the setup, and this is the hardware setup of the DC-DC converter. And then we have source, we have DC-DC converter, and then we have the load. So we have the load here. It is not a normal resistive load, that lamp load or a rheostat that you see in the lab. It is called electronic load. And it is very precise. Okay, and we have a source, we have the DC-DC converter, and then we have the load. Here actually what has been done is the DC-DC converter has been implemented in the digital platform only, and here we have the controller. Okay, and the controller, what it will do? It will take supply from sensor input from here, sensor input from here, and those sensors are kept here. Some of them are kept here. And then the controller, what it will do, it will decide a duty ratio, and then it will give it to the converter. And we have the the controller implemented in this digital platform, which we call it as OpelRT. Okay, so this is the whole experimental setup. Actually, I'm not going to discuss this experimental result. We don't have time for that. I will discuss about a very important concept. Just let me see this. Okay, which is Okay. Maximum PowerPoint extraction. I have a the same diagram I am drawing. Okay. So this is what, this is the output of either the fuel cell or the PV panel. Okay, right? This fuel cell output is what is dependent on the rate of flow of hydrogen, and rate of flow of hydrogen is not in your hand. It may change depending on the input. Okay.
I'm extremely sorry for that.
Okay, so shall I continue or we need to wind up? Then?
Yes, you can continue. The other participants are there.
Okay. It is back. Okay. So what I was saying is that what is this maximum power transfer theorem tells you? What does this maximum power transfer theorem tells you is that suppose you have a source and then there are certain components, and then you have a load. Okay, so under what case you can think of that in between these two points you have a large number of inductors, capacitors, resistance and anything, under what case the power that will be transferred to this load will be maximum? What does maximum power transfer theorem tells us? That in that case, what you have to do across these two sources, we have to find out RThevenin, and the moment RL becomes equal to RThevenin, we are able to extract maximum power from the source, isn't it? Yes. Okay, right. Now think of this case of a nonlinear circuit. What is our aim? We have a source which is variable, but the thing is that we should be able to extract maximum power from this source. Okay, right. Now consider this entire part as a load. Okay, you consider this entire path as a, this entire thing from here to here, that is the DC-DC converter as well as the actual load taken together as one load of ZL. Now, what is the condition for maximum extraction of power from the PV panel or from the fuel cell in this case? Tell me. Yes, please. Set input will be equal to Z Thevenin. It will be the conjugated. Yes or no? And Z input is what? Z input is nothing but it is the internal resistance of the, or the internal impedance of the source. Is it clear? Okay. So how can, once this condition we are able to do, we are able to achieve, then what we can claim? We can claim is that we are extracting maximum power from the PV panel irrespective of the weather condition, and we are extracting maximum power from the fuel source irrespective of the rate of flow of hydrogen or irrespective of the rate of the chemical reaction. Okay, right. Now the good thing about is that Z in, that is the source, the input impedance, we can always calculate because we have the current here, we have the voltage here, we can always calculate. So this Zin is known. And in this Z Thevenin, you have the, what is made up of Z Thevenin? Z Thevenin is made up of the inductor capacitor in the, what you call, in the DC-DC converter, and it is made up of the actual load. And at the same time, it is made up of D. This D, D is what? D is the duty ratio of the duty ratio of the DC-DC converter. The duty ratio of the DC-DC converter is also affecting Z Thevenin or not. This Z Thevenin is what? The impedance that we observe across these two terminals. This Z Thevenin is dependent on D or not. It is dependent on D. Okay, D is what? The duty ratio. So what I mean to say is that I can manipulate D in such a manner so that this condition is satisfied, in which this is constant, every other thing is constant here. So I can manipulate D so that this condition is met. Yes or no? So, or in other words, what I can say is that I can manipulate D. By manipulating D, I can extract maximum power from the fuel cell or I think I should now seek questions from you people. I'll be very happy to answer any of your questions.
So if you have anything, and here, just a minute. If you have any doubt with regard to what I have discussed, or anything that is somewhat related to it, okay. I am sharing some research papers. There actually you can get an idea. This all the I could not discuss a lot here, right? So if you want to know more about what we have, yeah, these are the three papers on which the everything that I have discussed. It was a part of the PhD work of my student Fani Teja, and this you can get more details about this modeling of fuel cell, and this controller design for fuel cell, and this maximum power point tracking from in fuel cell from these three papers. Okay, right. So now Ankita, if the participants have any doubt, I'll be very happy to answer those doubts and queries. Right.
Yes, sir. We are now open for the question and answer session. Dear participants, if you have any questions from our expert, please, you can ask now.
Yes. Okay. See, hydrogen generation, to some extent you are right actually. To hydrogen generation you need an electrolyzer system, okay, and for that electrolyzer system again there is an chemical chamber and all that, but for that working of that electrolyzer system again you need an electrical source, okay. So I could not discuss about that part. So again, the whole thing comes out to be energy management, right? So whenever you have excess power, you are using that power to run the electrolyzer. And once the electrolyzer runs, then you are having energy being produced, and that energy being produced, you can store. Okay, so that can be done, and not that can be done, but that is generally the major approach. That just as you charge a battery to store charge, okay, here also to produce hydrogen you are going through the same mechanism. You have a this electrolyzer. Before that electrolyzer again there is a DC-DC converter, so that excess power that you have, that is now used to run the electrolyzer, and that electrolyzer produces hydrogen, and that hydrogen is again used as a input to the fuel cell. So it is a whole cyclic process. No, actually, yeah, you are talking of this electrolyzer in an electric vehicle. Oh no, that actually is generally not done. So in electric vehicles now, this Tesla has come up with this. Not Tesla actually. Elon Musk has a very bad impression regarding fuel cell. Okay, I think GE has come up with a hydrogen chamber that they keep with it, and online hydrogen production they are not doing because it is not always safe. In submarines and all that, where you have a huge space, there that online hydrogen production facility is there. But considering the small space in electric vehicles, I don't know whether in bus they are doing it or not. But as such, to my idea, because of the safety concerns and hydrogen production online is generally not always preferable. So generally what you do is that you carry an hydrogen chamber along with, just as in this lab you have seen, now we have that red color cylinder similar to that we have in hospitals. So online energy production, online hydrogen production is not preferable because of safety concerns in electric vehicles. Gas stations you can have, because ultimately whenever you have that hydrogen box also, you have to get it refueled. Okay, and
So that is the problem, because coming people are not investing in the sense that this hydrogen gas production also is very costly affair. But I can tell you na, that one cylinder that we had na, with that cylinder we could work the entire student could complete his PhD. That is 3.5 years, day and night. He was not day and night, not 24/7. So with that cylinder he was able to complete it work, and we did not have to refuel it for 3 years. So that actually gives you an idea that refueling that hydrogen cylinder is not that frequent. Like battery, you have to almost on a daily basis you have to charge it, but the amount of hydrogen that is required to generate 1 kilowatt of one kilowatt of energy from a fuel cell is not that high. So even I have seen in DRDO they have these submarines. Like you can think of how big those submarines are, and then they don't have to, they remain in water for about 10 for a pretty long interval of time. The charging is not that frequent. Okay, so it is not that a big issue, because that frequent charging does not happen, so it is not that big issue. Okay.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for being with us. We'll connect with you for future events too.
Okay. Anyway, tomorrow.
Tomorrow we are meeting again.
Oh, tomorrow we are meeting. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much. Do we have any other questions from the participants? We can wind the session. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ankita. Thank you.
Thank you. Dear participants, kindly note.